How's it going? Oh my goodness. What are you guys doing here? You should be out solving this thing. Why are you? Raise your hand if you're done, if you've completely solved it. All right. Well done.
Good job, detectives.
How many people thought it was it hard? Where did it fall difficulty-wise for y'all? It was hard? I'm sorry. Yeah. Did you enjoy it though? Did you at least have fun? Okay. Cool. Well, we're gonna talk a little. Let me introduce my team. This is Brian Beam.
Hello, everybody.
My other producer on this. Sam, I'm blanking on your last name.
It's Pattison.
Sam Pattison and Lisa Woods. Sorry. My brain is a little fried today. These lovely people are from the Asunder app that you guys were using to look at fingerprints and blood and get calls from Chris Damaris, who's the number one hugger in the department.
I can verify that. Mm-hmm. I've gotten good hugs from him.
And then on the end here, we have Marcus Laporte, who did all your beautiful sets that you guys enjoyed.
Second best hugger at the...
Yeah. Your mic... Oh.
You can hear me, right?
Yeah. Yeah, we're thinking pretty. Are you guys? We can split. Oh, we'll figure it out. Okay. So I guess we'll just kind of walk y'all through the process of how this thing got made, and then we'll just open it up for questions if you guys want to hear some stuff. So this all started after I did 10 Little Roosters. That was kind of my attempt to look at what you could do with a web series as a medium. I've repeated this a bunch, so sorry if this feels redundant if you've been to some of the other panels. But that was me looking at a web series and trying to say, like, what can this medium do that other mediums can't? Because a lot of the stuff you see on the web now is like a web series, for the most part, is a shorter TV series, right? And so I was trying to see if it could be something more than that. And what's cool about the history of Rooster Teeth, especially, is that they've done this, you know, several times before. Red versus Blue is such a great example. They looked at something like Halo in an in-game engine, and they saw production software. You know, they saw special effects assets and all these things that other people didn't. And they used this medium of gaming for something else that it could do, and spawned what I think eventually became, you know, Let's Plays and all these other things. So kind of inspired by that and having done 10 Little Roosters, and I had done RTX last year actually as well, but I just had a handful of panels, and so coming into this year, I was trying to think, what could I do if the convention itself was viewed as a medium for entertainment? What kind of story could you tell and what kind of experience could you give? And so that was the genesis, and I think I had the crime scene idea fairly early, because that seemed such a great place with rich texture and this investigation you could do, and if you were retracing someone's day, you could go all over the convention trying to figure out what happened to this person. I think it ended up, did you guys end up walking a lot for this? So sweet, I should sell this to like Gatorade or something. So my initial iteration, though, was very pen and paper. It was like, okay, well, they're going to go, and they're going to have to kind of keep the clues themselves, and they're going to have to figure out the logic, and I didn't have video calls or anything. And then I'll let Brian take it from here.
So kind of my bad habit at Rooster Teeth is that I like to get us into new areas of trouble. And I'm one of the people at RT that figures out some way to go to South by Southwest every year. And one of the reasons I go is to go and try and find cool stuff that's going on that we can take and like integrate with what we're doing. And so Josh had been talking to me about where he was going next with, you know, the whole 10 Little Roosters thing. And I stumbled on, it was actually kind of inadvertent. I was running around and I've been really interested in VR lately, and South By this year had a whole thread on VR, but also just interactive AR, kind of augmented reality and virtual reality storytelling. And I walked into a panel that was dealing with using something called Bluetooth beacons as a narrative storytelling method. And the Asunder people and some other people were on this panel, and you know, they're talking about this really great thing that they did that they'll get into in a second, where they had a basically story that unraveled as you wandered around the bar district on the on 6th on the other side of 35, and suddenly things are connecting in my head that it's like, huh, we can apply this to what Josh is doing, and I think this might be the thing that, you know, because pen and paper works, but, you know, I think if we have some method to direct them, you know, it might help kind of smooth out some of the process, and it might allow us to do things that Rooster Teeth is really good at, like developing video content, you know, and so I kind of brought it to him as like, hey, you know, what if we do this? You know, what if we think about doing that? Go look at this app and, you know, take a look at it.
And what did that app do? That was your setup. Go.
Oh, what? Oh, we're on. Yeah, Lisa and I made this app because I think we were looking at some Bluetooth technology, and the only thing people seem to be using it for is to sell things to you in the store, give you a coupon or something. And I don't think we were interested in doing that at all. But we saw a play that was an audio play, and you would walk around this park here in town. Laguna Gloria, was that it? And it was in August, like now, so it was all hot, and it was like a swamp out there. And the play was Hamlet, I think, as performed by Scottish actors. And you would walk around and have to press play on a CD player to hear parts of it. So you hear these Scottish actors, you know, you're thinking there should be on the moors, but we're sitting in the middle of this Texas swamp, and it didn't really, like, connect at all with us. So we thought maybe we could use these Bluetooth beacons to add a little layer to stories if you're walking around town, to pick them up and maybe hear something in situ while you're there.
And as Josh mentioned, you guys were doing a lot of walking, and we kind of feel like people, I mean, you're staring at your phone a lot, right? And sometimes we've talked about how that gets in the way of people interacting with each other, especially in their environment. And so we wanted to think about, can we use the phone in a way that actually gets you out and looking at stuff and interacting with your environment more? So that was actually part of the drive for it as well.
Yeah. And with the sets, the way they are, Marcus, maybe you can talk about that. Like, I think that's the most interesting part of it for me is how that all interacts with the story, too.
Yeah. Yeah, let Marcus tell you how I stressed him out for the last 3 months. I want you to build a 1930s crime scene. Go.
Yeah, we were trying to be sort of time ambiguous. I mean, we're definitely in an era, but we knew that we would have to draw from a couple of different decades to really kind of complete the deal here. Obviously, the speakeasy is a little earlier than the 40s noir, but we were trying to kind of give everyone a little bit of all the fun stuff from the 20s to 40s. But yeah, we searched high and low for some period furniture and found lots of fun little things. And you know, you guys all saw it all already.
What did you think of the sets? Did you like the sets?
Yeah.
Did you like the CB lounge? That front projection screen, that was all Marcus. I was going to do this really cheap like Home Alone effect where I was going to put like two mannequins and just backlight it, and they were just going to be standing there like this. And he was like, I think I have a better idea.
Yeah, well, for a while I kind of went with the cardboard concept because I was like, well, we'll see how far this goes and let's just flesh out the idea and play with all the elements, and sometimes things come and go. So I try never to really... I never really poo-poo any idea that kind of comes through the creative process. I try to stay away from that part. You know, I'm there to motivate and enhance and make things cool, not to change the writer's creativity, hopefully. Sometimes we have limitations, and I have to say, well, we can't do that, but we could do this, and hopefully the this is still cool. So, but yeah, we did the front projection, and you guys probably noticed that the shadow was reversed. And that was basically when we did the footage first with the projector, we had a big white rectangle that was kind of blew the whole, you know, we were trying to allude that maybe this isn't a projector. We know, you know, that it's a projector, and we know, you know, that it's not really there, but you know, the best way for us to do that was to shoot some footage, but the regular shadow didn't look right because if you think about, you know, negative space and positive space with black and white, the shadow didn't look right because it didn't have any light there. So the only light that was anywhere was the frame. And that was what blew the gag. So we actually reversed late, you know, the night before.
Was it Thursday? It was something.
Yeah, it was like Thursday night, and we had set it up.
So we had black silhouettes against a white screen. We flopped it, so the white silhouettes with a black background.
Yeah, and what's cool is it ended up being kind of like a little nod to Sin City, which was something they did. And I actually worked on that movie, so I was like, well, this seems appropriate. So
yeah. So you're telling a little bit about your background, and then maybe have you ever done anything like this before where people were in a live space and had to be that?
Well, I've done some hidden camera commercials. There was a Ford Fusion commercial a couple years ago where we were on 6th Street and people pushed a button that was just on the street, and we invited you to push the button if you liked the car that you were seeing parked there that we had a big giant red arrow pointed at. and you know, it was kind of like an invitation, only we had a whole crew of people laying in wait. We had, you know, someone came out with an ice cream and gave you an ice cream. An attractive woman comes out of a bar and hands you a puppy. And then and you get a little further down the street and a, you know, jazz band comes out of, you know, one of the clubs there, you know, full jazz band, and just kind of follows you down the street. Then what else was it? Then a football team came down with cheerleaders and they threw a bunch of confetti and put you on a throne and carried you onto the street. So, and not everybody signed the release on that one, but, you know, but we got some good reactions. So I've done a little bit of that kind of thing, but this was much more immersive, much more intimate of an experience, and never really had this quantity of people before. So
yeah, and that was a big challenge too. We worked hard because we had, especially when it was a pen and paper thing, we were trying to think of what we could have you do that wasn't just like looking at stuff and taking notes. So like for a while, there was a black light section where you'd physically pick up a black light and scan a wall and kind of write down, you know, whatever was there. And that evolved into the fingerprints and the blood spatter. But that became a thing of trying to get enough people through it. We thought, oh, man, if we have black lights, like people will bottleneck there. They won't know if, you know, you'll have people who won't know when they found all the clues, so they'll probably just keep going for like an hour. And so there's a lot of logistics challenges like that you don't think of until you're really in the thick of it. You're like, oh man, are people gonna, you know, like how do you spread them out? Which is one of the reasons, besides just being fun and a bit nonlinear, that, you know, when you leave the crime scene, you do have like five or six leads you can go do. So you don't have just people training from each one. I love those silhouettes so much in the speakeasy. Like, it looks like Disneyland to me. So I feel like would you guys want to talk about anything specific? Yeah, go for it.
So when we created the app, really what it did, it's a media player in kind of a, to use an old term, multimedia kind of way, right? It plays videos, it plays audio, it has the augmented reality, it can display text. So really everything beyond that is the set, the story, like how it all links together. Because the app, in the simplest terms, is basically just playing you media, which I think is amazing. What you did is that you've really concocted a fantastic story that pulls you and pushes you through various scenarios and various, you know, video calls and what have you.
Thanks. My big thing was, because especially when we announced it, a lot of people kept asking, they're like, is it a puzzle room? Is it interactive theater? I don't think it's... There's elements of some of those things, but it's kind of its own beast. Maybe you guys know something that it's similar to. There's pieces of a scavenger hunt in there. But it's very. I'm just blanking. Sorry, I was going somewhere with that. I wanted to make it the, you know, as seamless and as immersive as I possibly could, and not so. A good counterexample is like I actually really enjoy puzzle rooms. I think they're really fun. We have a couple great ones here in Austin, but there is a like those have the same issue. They're more like mimicking the way a video game puzzle works, right? And so you go in this room, there's all these things, and the same thing is, you know, you stumble on a puzzle in a mansion in Resident Evil, you know, 4 or whatever. You go there and you're like, well, you know, people wouldn't really build a house where they had to push 200-pound statues to open their door every day. But because it's a video game, you have that suspension of disbelief, right? You're willing to go with it. You're like, okay, I know this is a game, so this isn't super realistic. Puzzle rooms have that same feel to me. They're really fun, but ultimately you're not like, okay, well, someone's created this. So unless you're reenacting Saw or something, you know, you are it's requiring a bigger suspension of disbelief on your end. So my goal was to try and eliminate that and have logic puzzles and things that made sense within the narrative. So, you know, when you're trying to find the speakeasy, the things you're finding are supposed to be that's the same way the criminals find it. You know, they have their own secret marks on walls. Or when you're in the crime scene, everything in there, you know, ultimately adds up and makes sense why it's there, and you get that narrative backing. Or you get that. I may eventually release, like, I have a full breakdown of, like, how all this works, like, when people are where, and, like, but, you know, like, so, like, the killer immediately goes to the phone after she dumps the body, and so there's a blood trail that leads to the phone, which is why. Hopefully that, did it feel pretty organic for the most part? Awesome.
You know, the other big thing was just trying to help people feel like they were part of it.
Right.
You know, I mean, that's where kind of the theater element comes in, and you know, the great thing about the app is that it was able to, you know, push some of those. You know, like, I think my favorite thing in there is super simple, but, you know, just having to hold your finger down to, mm-hmm. like, trigger it to start.
Yeah.
You know, just like, okay, the story is beginning.
Right, you're already in it before.
I mean, it was more than just hitting start. It was like, you have to actively engage and say, you know, I'm going to do this story.
Yeah. Did y'all catch that story pay off later, too, for scanning fingerprints? Why the victim has no fingerprints? Anyone catch that?
And also the fact that it was, I mean, we made the app into the detective tool.
Right.
Right, to kind of keep that theatrical, like, why would you be carrying around your phone looking for the stuff that makes no sense?
Yeah.
Can you talk more about you guys, how that came out?
Yeah. So, I mean, that was a big goal, too, was, like, not to look like, oh, you're looking at a device on a phone. It's like, it needs to feel like this phone is your tool. Like, Joel says in the opening, he's like, I see you've already checked out the armory. And so everyone just, you've already got it. You're already in the world. It's just like a good movie or a good story. You are starting late into the story. Like, you already live in this world, and we're just trying to catch you up, kind of.
Yeah, and I think the screens are quite good at that. I think you all did a great job with the videos in particular to make it look like the phone was still on. And I'm curious how many people had trouble with the app out here. Nearly everyone? Yeah. At the Marriott, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, we kind of had to, unfortunately, make you just take a picture of nothing and then show it to you in the evidence. I don't know why, but our... maybe it was the Wi-Fi, but I don't know, recognition of those images was not working particularly quickly.
Yeah. Yeah, so you could still get the evidence even if it didn't load. I know it's working. How many of y'all went to the crime scene not today? How many of y'all went earlier? Okay, yeah. Today, I mean, I was in this morning. It's working perfect. So we were smoothing some stuff out. If you went Friday especially, we were all in crisis mode Friday.
We did not get a full walkthrough of the app and get all the bugs out until something like 5:30 p.m.
Yeah, I think we greenlit the crime scene. I was trying to hold it, I think, and then they just opened it or something. And we had tested that. We knew the crime scene worked, and we were still out testing, and they opened it. And we're like, oh, God, there's going to be people, like, right behind us. So we were, like, right in front.
Yeah, and the thing is, they beat us. How did that happen? We were going as quickly as possible, knowing exactly where we needed to be from clue to clue.
Yeah.
And the people that beat us.
Yeah, yeah. How did y'all do it so fast? Yeah. Like, we know where to win. I was running almost.
I don't know who found the phone number in that Rolodex and called it, but that was pretty clever. Somebody got some phone calls.
Yeah, explain that.
Okay, so we rented some stuff from a prop house, and some of the items are, you know, clearly someone's stuff from a long time ago. And in the Rolodex there were phone numbers, and we just didn't really think about that, but people were calling those numbers, and so I don't know how many hundreds of phone calls you guys made, but there was definitely somebody. I don't know how it got back to us, but yeah. I think some of the guardians were like, I think someone's making phone calls on the phone numbers on this Rolodex, and
there's another phone number story.
Yeah. Oh, you've got one here.
Yeah. So you might have called me actually. I had. Yes, it was. I was just doing it right before we came on. If you called me, my number wasn't supposed to be in there. They were all numbers that were set up before.
Yeah.
But they were placeholders, numbers, and I apologize for that. But if you did call me, maybe you heard me try to wave your hand in the air or do a jumping jack. And if you did, that was me trying to pretend like it was all part of the game. And I apologize for that.
Well, I remember we were testing the store site, right? And like someone was telling, like, was in person telling us, are they here? I don't know. Someone was telling us, like, yeah, we called on the numbers and someone answered. We were like, oh no. And then, yeah. And then, like, literally, like, I looked over, or you answered your phone like 5 seconds later, and we're like, who is this? Like, it was total. So it was, and then it took me a second to gel, like, oh,
They're literally calling me right now. I have 5 missed phone calls.
So there's some things to iron out.
You should answer one.
Yeah, put it on speakerphone.
If anybody calls again, I'll answer. Maybe if you guys want to take the call.
Yeah, you want to. Wait. Oh, wait. Here we go.
Here's one right now. Reno, Nevada, you're on the air. Hi, detective. You're live at a panel at RTX.
I know. And we're watching you on CCTV right now. That's okay. No, we're laughing with you, not at you, I swear.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, I tell you what. Can you put your hand in the air and wave it around a little bit? We've got to make sure it's you before I give you the real numbers that I stole off the phone. Wait, are you doing it? Can you wave your hand a little higher? Oh, I see you now. That's great. All right. Thanks very much. I'll text you the numbers right now. All right. Good luck, detective.
Sam, that is a developer going above and beyond the Call of Duty.
Yeah.
Should definitely incorporate that on purpose.
Yeah.
For sure.
Well, that's a bit of a segue. Because I can talk a little bit about the video calls and versus live actors. Because again, the thing people kept asking was, is this going to be interactive theater? People, you know, is Joel or whoever actually going to be running around as the chief? And again, that to me, that came down to, well, besides time, I don't know if you've ever tried to snag a Rooster Teeth person here, but they're like lightning; they're always gone. But there's also, again, there's a suspension of disbelief thing, like where either you have to pretend like you're the character, or they're, you know, everyone's pretending, and to me it's so much more organic if it's, you know, there's still a little because you're pretending you're getting a video call, but hopefully, you know, we added enough texture to it. You know, I think the app looks great for one, and works really well, and we added on the video end, we added, you know, the little static blips and all these things to try and make that feel, you know, as real as possible, as well as little stuff. So I talked about this a little earlier on the writing for video game writing inspiration panel, but do you guys know Hideo Kojima? You guys play Metal Gear Solid? So I stole so much stuff from him for this, especially the earphone puzzle. I'm sorry about that. Yeah. Psycho Mantis. But he had a game on Sega CD that is one of my favorite games ever. If you get a chance to play it, you totally should. It's called Snatcher. And it's this weird mix of like Blade Runner and Invasion of the Body Snatchers. It takes place in kind of a futuristic Tokyo, and the guy's looking for these androids that look like people, and they're killing people and replacing them. It's a really good story, but they do a lot of, they have, it's kind of this like a Blade Runner thing where they get these future video calls, but they have these little devices and there's little textural things about it I love, and ripped for this, for instance, having you guys, you know, having Chris as the operator call you and then connect you to other people and having that illusion. That little step to me, like, I don't know, that does so much other than just someone always calling you, because then it starts to feel more like a, you know, you're playing like a 90s FMV game, like you're playing Command and Conquer and Tim Curry's yelling at you or something. But just having, you know, the like people simulating, like, okay, you are, you know, the receptionist is calling you, now they're going to transfer your call to the chief, and I don't know. There's something about those little touches. Did y'all like that? Did that make it more for you? Okay, cool.
By the way, where did you get a Sega CD player? I would love to play it sometime.
I own it. I bought it when it came out, like an idiot. yeah, it's in my closet. Cool. What are you up to?
You know, we could talk about, you were talking about storytelling mechanisms. We went back and forth a lot in trying to figure out, you were talking about using the phone, but we went through some other things. We thought about using virtual reality at one point.
Yeah.
It was trying to figure out the balance of just like what is enough to keep you active, but
and keep it varied.
Keep
too.
It varied, yeah. But not necessarily make you, just like, you know, one of the reasons we decided not to use virtual reality on top of some development time, which is the big thing, but also just like the phone was your device. And so if we were going to make you take your phone and then put it into a Google Cardboard and put it on, all of a sudden, like, you're stepping out of
yeah.
the experience.
You're holding a phone again. And yeah. Yeah, there's a lot. I mean, there's so much stuff on the cutting room floor for this that didn't make it for time or just I think would ultimately be better served in a different project. So if you guys like this thing, you should, you know.
I mean,
like,
would you guys want to continue this investigation?
There's some really, I don't want to say anything though, because we're telling you, but I mean, we had talked about some AR ideas about how you can green screen people and things like that. That is just, the applications are awesome. And also, just genre wise, you can do so much, you know. So this time it's very, you know, detective noir, gumshoe kind of feel, but you know, you get pieces for like a more Minority Report esque one. Like, I had ideas for like a superhero one. There's so many like ways you can take the stories.
Yeah, we started exploring some of the AR, like, so I actually have to commend Sam and Lisa and Josh and Marcus, because it's like I moved over to Laser Team a few months ago, and like I've been like super gone off the grid, like I haven't seen my friends or coworkers in months, and I see you on Monday. Yeah, I go to the office once a week on Monday for an hour to see everybody at the meeting, and then I go back to work. But yeah, so they developed this app, this story, in like a really short amount of time, and you know what they were able to accomplish is really, really impressive.
Thanks. I was pretty impressed that you had the idea for the script, mm-hmm. and you went from, you know, fleshing out the script, all of the clues, all of the videos. It was like a month, and I think our development time was about a month too.
I think everyone, and then Marcus, I think he had like. Yeah, he had 2 weeks.
we had to just wait, you know. We couldn't really do anything here. And we actually didn't get in here until, I guess, Thursday at 6 p.m.
Yeah, so that crime scene was built in 18 hours.
Yeah.
I slept on the floor under a sound blanket like a hobo. Yeah. It was great.
And I almost did that, but I was like, no, I need new clothes.
You didn't want to sleep in the hotel bed?
Well, I wasn't offered a hotel. So.
Oh, no, in the crime scene.
Oh, just in the crime scene.
I was like, there was no hotel for me. Yeah, and I was like, nobody sit on the pillow.
Why did you, what is the story there? See, Marcus, I was going to jump on the bed as a joke, and he's like, don't do that, cat piss. And I was like, what the hell does that mean?
When we went and picked up some of the stuff, I mean, they're like, you know, it's in this guy's, if you don't know, we have a guy named Tom Cole. He has a lot of old stuff, and it gathers dust, and he has a big warehouse full of period items. And, you know, they don't get rented very often. So when we go in there, you know, you never know what you're going to find. So it's like, you know, raccoons or, you know, there's like animals in his warehouse sometimes. So I just, you know, this pillow smelled a little funny, and I just wanted to make sure you didn't go lay your, you know, head on it. That's all. Your pretty hair.
Thank you. I did just get it cut and shampooed on Thursday. So
Sam and Lisa, what did you think when, like, you guys didn't know who Rooster Teeth were, did you? When we, like, kind of came up out of the blue? It was like, what's your experience been like? It was just like,
I've been amazed at just the community here. Everybody seems so nice, and you have like so much fun. And I think 3 weeks. I mean, I'd heard of Red versus Blue, obviously. I mean, that's everywhere. I remember when that came out and being amazed that someone thought of such an awesome idea. to save so much money and time to make a show, you know? It was great. But everybody we've met here has been super nice and super friendly, and I maybe you guys don't know how many people are, like, behind the scenes, like, doing all of this stuff. Even the Guardians have been great, and they've been stayed, like, you know, the volunteer actors at the speakeasy. That Jake Hill, who answers the door, isn't he fantastic? Yeah.
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 I think everybody, I've just been really amazed by the community, and everybody, I really, really want to watch more Rooster Teeth now for sure. Woo.
Let's see how we're doing on time. Okay, we're doing good.
Should we move to questions, or do you have anything else you want to cover?
I feel like there was something, but I forgot.
My brain is so gone.
I know. Feedback. I mean, did you guys feel like you got a cohesive experience? Did you like the story? Like, did you feel like you got a good full story? How many people thought someone they were talking to on the video calls was going to end up being bad? Okay. Damn it. I tried to design that where they felt more like a advisory mechanism, and the suspects were the only ones that mattered. Yeah. How many people knew it was going to be Chris? How many people thought it was going to be someone else? Anyone think it was going to be Joel or Barbara or someone or Aaron? Oh, but it's a different Barbara. Did you look at the last names? All the last names are like nonsense. Look at Marcus made that. Yeah. Mine's like a...
I was going to use real names, and then at some point, it was like, no, that's gonna confuse the audience with the actual characters that are in there. And so I was like, well, I kind of need to... I want to use Rooster Teeth names, so I just started, finding... little funny little things. Was it Dunkermang or something?
Yeah. I think mine...
It was Barra Dunkermang.
Yeah. And mine was like a weird... if y'all know Zach, I don't know if this was your intention, but like... Yeah, like mine looked like the love child of me and Zach Anner. It was Josh Flynn Anner.
I thought for a moment it was one of the names that's... Basil calls the little girl in the Great Mouse Detective. Mm-hmm. Miss Flanger
Tanger. I was pretty delirious at that point, and I was just like, okay, I'll just start, rhyming and finding, little synonyms for these last names.
Yeah.
And it was based off Ernie Smulders, though.
Yeah, Ernie Smulders was mine. Yeah. Wasn't that good?
And then I was like, okay, if that's his idea, then I know I'm safe to kind of play off that same.
Well, that was the thing, too. I kind of wanted to, even though it's at Rooster Teeth, I wanted to use the expo, but I wanted to make it a standalone story. So it wasn't, it was like, that worked in 10 Little Roosters, but this one was going to be... The people are going to be playing characters, even though they're, iterations of themselves.
So out of curiosity, just so that I know who to, beware of in the room, how many went bad at the end? Okay, let's...
Yeah. Oh, how many people enjoyed the... Did you guys enjoy the Rooster Teeth cameos that are all over it? Did you guys... Did y'all call all the phone numbers besides his? Yeah, he like... I was worried some of those were going to throw people off. Like, his and Lindsay's was like a voluntary amputation business or something. And I was like, I wondered. Yeah, I knew someone was going to think that. I'd hoped the timeline would clear that up, which is supposed to be the point, because Miles' phone call comes during the murder, which means he's busy, and then the other one, shortly after. But, yeah, when you have people pitching stabbing companies, it's... Do y'all know who that was? No, it's Matt. It's Matt Hullum. Yeah, same in the speakeasy, too. There's a bunch of people talking. That's Ryan again and John Reisinger.
Gray is
Blaine.
In there.
Yep, Aaron. Yep.
Haley.
No, she's the silhouettes. The silhouettes and the people are different. So, yeah, it's different voices. I think we could do questions. That was Jen Brown.
Jen Brown? Okay. I thought it was.
What's her... I'm going to mess her character up. Someone knows.
She's Carolina.
Carolina, thank you. Yeah, Carolina and Red
Roses. She's Agent Iowa.
I don't think if anyone else was in there. I think that's... Yeah.
I think that's a pretty... Yeah, I think that's
yeah. Do you guys want to do some... Do you get questions? Do people have questions? I hope so. What's the mechanism? Raised hands.
I think you start with the pink hair.
Cool. Yeah. Where? Oh, okay. I know you. Yes, we're gonna film. I'm running around today, and then I have a signing over at JW, so I'm gonna pick up the last piece there. But I'm gonna film the speakeasy and all the beacons and stuff. So that was one of the things we wanted to do for people who couldn't be here was to film a little bit like a narrative walkthrough of the whole thing, where you could post the videos online and things like that. So that'll be coming out probably in the next few weeks. So, which also means when we do it again, even if we were to keep the detective thing, we'd have to make a totally new story and puzzles. So yeah.
Aww.
Let's see. Green shirt.
Yeah, at the end of all of this, will you guys be able to track any of the statistics, like how many people went through with it, and how many people did pick good versus bad, things like that?
I think the Guardians are keeping some tally of that at the end goal. I know a ton of people were finishing yesterday. I know as of yesterday, only like low 50s had finished, like 52 people or something. Only 4 people finished it Friday. Are they here? Are my friends? There you are. Yeah.
Though, 10 minutes before this panel, we had 2,200 different sessions, according to, but that's just on iOS.
Yeah.
Yeah, those numbers hopefully will go up, right?
We're trying to track it as best we can because we're curious too, and if there's a way to get more people through, and also as a sexy sales tool for people to sponsors to throw money at us, so we can make a bigger, awesomer one each time. So, yeah, let's see, hey, blue. Yeah. So the clue, I don't think a lot of people did. Did anyone figure that out? The website is the Rooster Teeth website. So if you go, they talk about he's involved in the Rooster Teeth. This might have been a little obtuse, but so he's using the alias Ernie Smolders, and he's involved in the Rooster Teeth community. I think the clue, I don't remember what the text is in the app, but it's something, it's hopefully like, what else was he involved in? And what does that mean? Blah, blah, blah. So if you actually go to the Rooster Teeth, Rooster Teeth website, roosterteeth.com, type in Ernie Smolders. There is a fake profile for Ernie Smolders, and you will see on his comment wall that he has had a conversation with Kerry Kilpowski, and they agreed to, he sequestered to stay with him for the weekend at RTX, so that's why he was in the room. Cool. Yes, sir. There's blood trails there. Mixing, because there's a little troubleshooting tech-wise, and even with if you did the QR version, that just literally tells you where to go. But you basically find the blood you find in the chalk outline will give you a picture, and that if you go there and scan the thing, there's a blood trail that leads under the escalators. You go there, another picture. You kind of follow this 3 trail. It eventually takes you to the payphone. So there's 3 different locations on the way. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Probably not Windows. we only have one developer on in our company, and it's me, and. so that's why the Android app couldn't come out, and I apologize to all you Android users, but yes, definitely we're thinking of making one.
Yeah, I think if this happens again next year, which I hope it does, so make noise out there, say, I love this, I want to get married there.
Seriously, tweeting about it and stuff like that is really, really helpful in terms of us being able to do more.
Yeah. But yeah, I think I can say with pretty good certainty that if we come back and do it again next year, we will put that will be my top priority. We'll be having the Android version ready too. So let's see. I'm gonna go to the back. Are you raising your hand?
Yeah.
Okay.
We have a story right now on the east side of Austin called Live at the Dead Horse Drum.
Cool. And is it outside in any other cities?
No, not yet. We're developing a lot of different stories outside of Rooster Teeth, but I want to keep your expectations kind of low. They are not nearly as immersive or as cool as this one.
But you can talk a little bit about that one, about the one that's in East Austin right now. So you guys basically went around outside, hid beacons and trees and wherever else, right? And now you can just go with the app and go there, and it'll ping you when you're...
Yeah, this story is not so... it's more of a collage story, I guess. So you get bits and pieces of a story, but they don't necessarily have to be linear or taken in any particular order. But you get more of a... It's more of a pastiche where the story is sort of enveloped all in pieces.
Yeah, it's a non-linear story. It doesn't have like a definitive end. You go and you get the pieces, and it's just more about walking there and being in the area. Yeah.
And you guys have developed an API, haven't you? Or
we're working on it. So Asunder is a really new app. Like, we basically presented it at South by in March. So just meeting Brian and working on this project has really kind of been our kind of big kind of entree into the thing. The story we had before was done with friends, you know, was done on zero budget, and it was more of a proof of concept. So we're hopefully going to develop more.
Yeah, I think our first story had 40 viewers total, and I know that 20 of them were my friends.
wouldn't you like these guys to develop more with us, to do more things like this?
And Sam's phone's still ringing.
I missed it.
He missed. Yeah, we'll wait. We'll do one final one if they call back at the end.
Should do a speakerphone so we can hear them.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. We'll see. We'll wing it if they come.
I was just saying if we get them, we should put the
phone on. Speakerphone.
I don't. I feel that's a lot of pressure. You did so good. To answer.
Yeah, speakerphone, just so we can hear them talking.
You can just still put it on speakerphone. You don't need me for that. I can just hang out. To answer that question, I mean, I would love to do more of this stuff. This kind of stuff is like outside of Rooster Teeth. We just have to figure out a way to make it, you know, feasible and be able to get people to do it. And I don't know. Well, I'm sure after this we'll have lots of brainstorming and figure some cool stuff out. In the blue. That might be coming out. Did people see that? Did no one see that trailer yesterday? Like in their city or wherever they are, or what?
If we were to do that, it would have to probably be a different mechanism. So the way Asunder works and what they've developed is very location. Like, you need, you know, it works really well for doing theatrical and storytelling stuff because you're walking around and accessing the beacons. There would have to be something else that, you know, would be kind of more web-centric, probably.
Yeah, I mean, if you when we do 11 Little Roosters next year, there will be some more interactive scavenger hunty type things with it. It's a different form of interaction than 10 Little Roosters was. But it's I think those are both very catered again, like to their mediums. So this is a live medium. It's a little hard. There's probably a way to do it. We'd have to really find a cool hook, though, to it, and a mechanism that would let us do that.
You know, there was another panel during that whole South by programming that, you know, I think could apply.
Was that the Game of Thrones one?
Yeah, it was the Game of Thrones one.
Oh, yeah, that was cool.
That was really cool. So who knows? Maybe.
No, there was. There's a Game of Thrones advertising panel about their advertising campaign in.
It was in Spain, and it was done by like the Spanish distributor of Game of Thrones, and they basically had another country in that world that was put together, and there was a rebel that they staged an event to introduce, like a live event in Madrid, and then it expanded out into like there was a Facebook thing and a Twitter, and basically and it's hard to explain the mechanism, but people were allowed to go to war against each other on a specific day every week. And based on the way the wars went, there were factions and stuff that rose up, and they joined together into different armies. And the leader of the top army was declared king in a crowning ceremony in Spain. It was like, yeah, if you go to, I can try and find the link, but South By has audio archives of all the panels, and the one for this panel was super crazy. It was like all of the stuff they were talking. It was like, oh my god, really? What? It was like, but yeah, they had a whole crowning ceremony with like a procession through Madrid. Like they put this guy up, you know, in a chair that they were carrying down the street, and it was really, really cool.
Man,
so maybe 11 little roosters.
Yeah. Yep. Gentleman in the hat. I think just finally seeing it all come together, because for so many, you know, for weeks and weeks, it's there's so many individual moving parts. I mean, Marcus is working on the sets, and Sam and Lisa are working on the app, and we, you know, we're throwing art assets between everyone, and I'm making the videos and all stuff. But it's such so many separate pieces, and you really don't see it come together. I think maybe the week before this, we did a test of the app, and I got to see the videos in action. And I, even around the office, this was a hard thing to, like, people couldn't wrap their head around it for some reason when I would pitch it. And I was like, okay, like, and when we got the app in their hands, and I got to go around the office and show it to them, like, they got it. They're like, oh, but like, that is so cool. And then finally, when we got the set built, you know, all the staff that have come through it have just like, you get it, you know, like, when you get here and see it, and even trying to advertise it to people before, like, I mean, you guys are here now, like, did it take you coming here to see it to really understand what it was? Yeah. And so I think, yeah, just seeing it come together like that, easily my favorite part.
I'm curious of the woman who said no.
No.
I basically had a pretty good idea of what was going to be happening.
Sweet.
Cool. Well, good job.
I've done a lot of interactive stuff before, so.
Cool. Is this like anything you've done?
Yeah, a little bit. What's
a good example?
Well, it's less, I've never done much where you go out. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So,
but there you go. There's the end. That's the word I'm looking for. Cool.
I was just going to say, you know, because I've been kind of away working on Laser Team, walking into the CB Lounge the other day, it was just like my mind was blown. Just like I had this kind of look of glee on my face. It was just like, oh my god, it's all happening. Just like it's here.
It's really like, great. I mean, like Marcus, you really did a phenomenal job with that space. I mean, if you guys like, you guys are in a room. Like this is what that room looks like. Like the room you're in now, and he really transformed it and used light in just the right places and curtains. And I mean, like it's.
The lighting was amazing to kind of see.
How do you do those fans?
Yeah. Well, the lights, it's called a gobo. It's just a little disc of metal that's been cut into a profile. It's kind of like a vector art, so if you know what that is, it's essentially what we do. We have it custom made, and then there's a little motor that spins that. It's called a twin spin, and you can put two of them in there, but one of them really was the only one that made sense. So, but I just was trying to get a sense of movement, and you know, when you see films from the 40s and that whole film noir thing, it's, you know, you get the mini blind, you get the fan effect, and, you know, high contrast, you know. And so that's kind of what we were going for. But, yeah, I mean, I just felt like, oh, I've got these little corners and these little dioramas and I've got these little sets, and how do we make the room? Well, we had to explode the room, you know. It's like, how do we put 30 or 40 people in what would normally be a, you know, 12 by 12 space or something? Mm-hmm. So
we had to sort of explode things and put things in corners so that we could give everybody the room that they needed to do what they wanted without feeling crowded. Yeah. So,
and there's the tech side of that too. So all the things had to be far enough apart where you wouldn't be overlapping beacons all the time and like everything just like blowing up your phone. So there's so many again like moving pieces and logistics that were just
it was a lot
working concurrently, and then finally they all lined up.
It was good.
Yeah.
And we used period bulbs. I don't know if anyone caught that, but we didn't have a single regular light bulb in almost any of our spaces. They were all the high filament bulbs that can be dimmed. I wanted to be able to dim, and you know, CFLs don't do that really very well anymore unless you get a special one, and I just felt like the quality of light isn't going to be the same at all. So it was really important to me to get that glowing filament was a real important thing to have for our space.
This is why Marcus got hired at Rooster Teeth after Laser Team.
That's true.
Cool. I think we have time for one more. I already asked the gentleman with the glasses. How do you make the CB Launch what?
Matchbooks.
How do we make it, Marcus? I think that was a pretty simple. One of the simplest problems we have.
That was done weeks and weeks before we did anything else because it took about a month to turn, you know, for a company to actually turn that around. So we just kind of created a CB Lounge logo way early and just kind of got it in while we could. But yeah, it was just a company that makes the matchbooks, and you know, you can plug. It's just like if you're familiar with like Cafe Press or Zazzle, it's very similar. You just upload your image. You specify your wants and needs, and they had foil and metallic, stamps, and I thought that was great. So that's what we ended up doing.
That's a great example of how we decided not to make something digital and make it physical instead. Because originally it was just supposed to be a piece of evidence in your phone, and then at some point someone's like, you know what, these would be much cooler with it as a little takeaway, a souvenir.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we wanted you guys to have a piece of what you experienced, and we thought that would be a fun little thing to take home. So. Yeah.
But I will say, on the digital versus physical, every time Marcus came to me and he was like, do we have to make this? I'm like, no, it's digital. He's like, oh, thank God.
we said the same thing on our end. Like, is this digital? No, it's physical. Thank God.
Just volleying the work back and forth.
We all met in the middle somewhere. It was good.
Oh, here we go. Ready. To end ready. The panel.
I'm going
to
let you. You did such a good job. Just put it on speaker.
Hello, detective. You're on the air.
Hi.
Hi, Detective. Would you like to say hi to the to an RTX panel?
Hi. Hi.
Okay, well.
Or not.
That's all right. You don't have to talk all that much. But I think I know why you're calling me.
Wait, are you getting another one at the same time? Oh.
Yes. Sorry about that, y'all.
That's okay. Anyway. He was getting one and then got another call mid, so you're just going to be a fun day. Oh, and there's another one. What's happening? Oh, it hung
Hello?
Up. I don't know. No, I think it's dead. All right, I'm afraid we're out of time. I've got to run across to the JW like I made you guys do. But thank y'all so much for coming out. Thanks for playing, and I really hope you guys enjoyed it. So. Someone was trying to get John to make a shirt. I don't know.
Me and Lisa.
Just you two.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have a good day.
Hi.
I don't know who found the phone number in that Rolodex and called it, but that was pretty clever. Somebody got some phone calls.
Yeah, explain that.
Okay, so we rented some stuff from a prop house, and some of the items are, you know, clearly someone's stuff from a long time ago. And in the Rolodex there were phone numbers, and we just didn't really think about that, but people were calling those numbers, and so I don't know how many hundreds of phone calls you guys made, but there was definitely somebody. I don't know how it got back to us, but I think some of the guardians were like, I think someone's making phone calls on the phone numbers on this Rolodex, and
There's another. There's another phone number story.
Yeah. Oh, you've got one here.
Yeah. So you might have called me actually. I had. Yes, it was. I was just doing it right before we came on. If you called me, my number wasn't supposed to be in there. They were all numbers that were set up before.
Yeah.
But they were placeholders numbers, and I apologize for that. But if you did call me, maybe you heard me try to wave your hand in the air or do a jumping jack. And if you did, that was me trying to pretend like it was all part of the game. And I apologize for that.
Well, I remember we were testing the store site, right? And like was in person telling us, are they here? I don't know. Someone was telling us like, yeah, we called on the numbers and someone answered. We were like, oh no. And then yeah. And then like literally like I looked over or you answered your phone like 5 seconds later and we're like, who is this? Like it was it took me a second to gel, like, oh,
They're literally calling me right now. I have 5 missed phone calls.
So there's some things to iron out.
You should answer one.
Yeah, put it on speakerphone.
If anybody calls again, I'll answer. Maybe if you guys want to take the call.
Yeah, you want to. Wait. Oh, wait. Here we go.
Here's one right now. Reno, Nevada, you're on the air.
Hi, detective. you're live at a panel at RTX.
I know. And we're watching you on CCTV right now. That's okay. No. We're laughing with you, not at you, I swear. Yeah. Hey, I tell you what. Can you put your hand in the air and wave it around a little bit? We've got to make sure it's you before I give you the real numbers that I stole off the phone. Wait, are you doing it? Can you wave your hand a little higher? Oh, I see you now. That's great. All right. Thanks very much. I'll text you the numbers right now. All right. Good luck, detective.
Sam, that is a developer going above and beyond the Call of Duty.
Yeah.
Should definitely incorporate that on purpose.
Yeah. Well, that's a bit of a segue, because I can talk a little bit about the video calls and versus live actors. Because again, the thing people kept asking was, is this going to be interactive theater? People, you know, is Joel or whoever actually going to be running around as the chief? And again, that to me, that came down to, well, besides time, I don't know if you've ever tried to snag a Rooster Teeth person here, but they're like lightning; they're always gone. But there's also, again, there's a suspension of disbelief thing, like where either you have to pretend like you're the character, or they're, you know, everyone's pretending, and to me it's so much more organic if it's, you know, there's still a little because you're pretending you're getting a video call, but hopefully, you know, we put added enough texture to it. You know, I think the app looks great for one, and works really well, and we added on the video end, we added, you know, the little static blips and all these things to try and make that feel, you know, as real as possible. As well as little stuff. So I talked about this a little earlier on the writing for video game writing inspiration panel. But do you guys know Hideo Kojima? You guys play Metal Gear Solid? So I stole so much stuff from him for this. Especially the earphone puzzle. I'm sorry about that. Yeah. Psycho Mantis. But he had a game on Sega CD that is one of my favorite games ever. If you get a chance to play it, you totally should. It's called Snatcher. And it's this weird mix of like Blade Runner and Invasion of the Body Snatchers. It takes place in kind of a futuristic Tokyo, and the guy's looking for these androids that look like people, and they're killing people and replacing them. It's a really good story. But they do a lot of, they have, it's kind of this, like a Blade Runner thing where they get these future video calls, but they have these little devices and there's little textural things about it I love. And I ripped for this, for instance, having you guys, you know, having Chris as the operator call you and then connect you to other people and having that illusion. That little step to me, like, I don't know, that does so much other than just someone always calling you. Because then it starts to feel more like a, you know, you're playing like a 90s FMV game, like you're playing Command and Conquer and Tim Curry's yelling at you or something. But just having, you know, the like people simulate, like, okay, you are, you know, the receptionist is calling you, now they're going to transfer your call to the chief and I don't know. There's something about those little touches. Did y'all like that? Did that feel, did that make it more for you? Okay, cool.
By the way, where did you get a Sega CD player? I would love to play it sometime.
I own it. I bought it when it came out like an idiot. yeah, it's in my closet. Cool. What are you up to?
You know, we could talk about, you know, you were talking about storytelling mechanisms. There, mm-hmm. We went back and forth a lot in trying to figure out, you know, you were talking about using the phone, but we went through some other things. We thought about using virtual reality at one point.
Yeah.
It was trying to figure out the balance of just like what is enough to keep you active, but
and keep it varied.
Keep
too.
It varied, yeah. But not necessarily make you, just like, you know, one of the reasons we decided not to use virtual reality on top of some development time, which is a big thing, but also just like the phone was your device. And so if we were going to make you take your phone and then put it into a Google Cardboard and put it on, all of a sudden, like, you're stepping out of
yeah.
the experience.
You're holding a phone again. And yeah. Yeah, there's a lot. I mean, there's so much stuff on the cutting room floor for this that didn't make it for time or just... I think would ultimately be better served in a different project. So if you guys like this thing, you should, you know.
I mean,
like,
would you guys want to continue this investigation?
There's some really, I don't want to say anything though, because we're telling you, but I mean, we had talked about some AR ideas about how you can green screen people and things like that. That is just, the applications are awesome. And also, just genre-wise, you can do so much, you know. So this time it's very, you know, detective noir gumshoe kind of feel. But you know, you get pieces for like a more Minority Report-esque one. Like, I had ideas for like a superhero one. There's so many like ways you can take the stories.
Yeah, we started exploring some of the AR. Like, so I actually have to commend Sam and Lisa and Josh and Marcus, because it's like I moved over to Laser Team a few months ago, and like I've been like super gone off the grid. Like, I haven't seen my friends or coworkers in months. And I see you on Monday. Yeah, I go to the office once a week on Monday for an hour to see everybody at the meeting, and then I go back to work. But yeah, so they developed this story in like a really short amount of time. And you know what they were able to accomplish is really, really impressive.
Thanks. I was pretty impressed that you had the idea for the script, mm-hmm. and you went from, you know, fleshing out the script, all of the clues, all of the videos. It was like a month, and yeah. I think our development time was about a month too.
Yeah, I think everyone, and then Marcus, I think he had like 2 weeks. Yeah, he had 2 weeks.
You guys probably noticed that the shadow was reversed. And that was basically when we did the footage first with the projector, we had a big white rectangle that was kind of blew the whole, you know, we were trying to allude that maybe this isn't a projector. We know, you know, that it's a projector, but, and we know, you know, that it's not really there, but you know, the best way for us to do that was to shoot some footage, but the regular shadow didn't look right because if you think about, you know, negative space and positive space with black and white, the shadow didn't look right because it didn't have any light there. So the only light that was anywhere was the frame, and that was what blew the gag. So we actually reversed mm-hmm. late, you know, the night before.
Was it Thursday? It was something.
Yeah, it was like Thursday night, and we had set it up.
So we had black silhouettes against a white screen. We flopped it, so the white silhouettes with the black background.
Yeah, and what's cool is it ended up being kind of like a little nod to Sin City, which was something they did, and I actually worked on that movie, so I was like, well, this seems appropriate. So
yeah. So you're telling a little bit about your background, and then maybe Have you ever done anything like this before where people were in a live space and had to be that?
Well, I've done some hidden camera commercials. There was a Ford Fusion commercial a couple years ago where we were on 6th Street and people pushed a button that was just on the street. And we invited you to push the button if you liked the car that you were seeing parked there that we had a big giant red arrow pointed at. And you know, it was kind of like an invitation, only we had a whole crew of people laying in wait. We had, you know, someone came out with an ice cream and gave you an ice cream. An attractive woman comes out of a bar and hands you a puppy. And then and you get a little further down the street and a, you know, jazz band comes out of, you know, one of the clubs there, you know, full jazz band and just kind of follows you down the street. Then what else was it? Then a football team came down with cheerleaders and they threw a bunch of confetti and put you on a throne and carried you onto the street. So, and not everybody signed the release on that one, but, you know, it was like, but we got some good reactions. So I've done a little bit of that kind of thing, but this was much more immersive, much more intimate of an experience, and never really had this quantity of people before. So
yeah, and that was a big challenge too. We worked hard because we had especially when it was a pen and paper thing, we were trying to think of what we could have you do that wasn't just like looking at stuff and taking notes. So like for a while, there was a black light section where you'd physically pick up a black light and scan a wall and kind of write down, you know, whatever was there. And that evolved into the fingerprints and the blood spatter. But that became a thing of trying to get enough people through it. We thought, oh man, if we have black lights, like people will bottleneck there. They won't know if, you know, you'll have people who won't know when they found all the clues, so they'll probably just keep going for like an hour. And so there's a lot of logistics challenges like that you don't think of until you're really in the thick of it. And you're like, oh man, are people gonna, you know, like how do you spread them out? Which is one of the reasons, besides just being fun and a bit nonlinear, that, you know, when you leave the crime scene, you do have like five or six leads you can go do. So you don't have just people training from each one. I love those silhouettes so much in the speakeasy. Like, it looks like Disneyland to me. So I feel like would you guys want to talk about anything specific? Yeah, go for it.
So when we created the app, really what it did, it's a media player in kind of a, to use an old term, multimedia kind of way, right? It plays videos, it plays audio, it has the augmented reality, it can display text. So really everything beyond that is the set, the story, like how it all links together. Because the app, in the simplest terms, is basically just playing you media, which I think is amazing. What you did is that you've really concocted a fantastic story that pulls you and pushes you through various scenarios and various, you know, video calls and what have you.
Thanks. My big thing was, because especially when we announced it, a lot of people kept asking, they're like, is it a puzzle room? Is it interactive theater? I don't think there's elements of some of those things, but it's kind of its own beast. Maybe you guys know something that it's similar to. There's pieces of a scavenger hunt in there. But it's very, I'm just blanking, sorry. I was going somewhere with that. I wanted to make it the, you know, as seamless and as immersive as I possibly could, and not so. A good counterexample is like I actually really enjoy puzzle rooms. I think they're really fun. We have a couple great ones here in Austin, but there is a like those have the same issue. They're more like mimicking the way a video game puzzle works, right? And so you go in this room, there's all these things, and the same thing is, you know, you stumble on a puzzle in a mansion in Resident Evil, you know, 4 or whatever. You go there and you're like, well, you know, people wouldn't really build a house where they had to push 200-pound statues to open their door every day. But because it's a video game, you have that suspension of disbelief, right? You're willing to go with it. You're like, okay, I know this is a game, so this isn't super realistic. Puzzle rooms have that same feel to me. They're really fun, but ultimately you're not like, okay, well, someone's created this. So unless you're reenacting Saw or something, you know, it's requiring a bigger suspension of disbelief on your end. So my goal was to try and eliminate that and have logic puzzles and things that made sense within the narrative. So, you know, when you're trying to find the speakeasy, the things you're finding are supposed to be that's the same way the criminals find it. You know, they have their own secret marks on walls. And when you're in the crime scene, everything in there, you know, ultimately adds up and makes sense why it's there. And you get that narrative backing. Or you get that I may eventually release, like, I have a full breakdown of, like, how all this works, like, when people are where and, like, but, you know, like, so, like, the killer immediately goes to the phone after she dumps the body, and so there's a blood trail that leads to the phone, which is why. Hopefully that, did it feel pretty organic for the most part? Awesome.
You know, the other big thing was just trying to help people feel like they were part of it.
Right.
You know, I mean, that's where kind of the theater element comes in. And, you know, the great thing about the app is that it was able to, you know, push some of those. You know, like, I think my favorite thing in there is super simple. But, you know, just having to hold your finger down to, like, trigger it to start.
Yeah.
You know, just like, okay, the story is beginning.
Right, you're already in it before.
Yeah. I mean, it was more than just hitting start. It was like you have to actively engage and say, you know, I'm gonna do this story.
Yeah. Did y'all catch that story pay off later too for scanning fingerprints? Why the victim has no fingerprints? Anyone catch that?
And also the fact that it was, I mean, we made the app into the detective tool.
Right.
Right. To kind of keep that theatrical, like, why would you be carrying around your phone looking for the stuff that makes no sense?
Yeah.
Can you talk more about you guys, how that came out?
Yeah. So I mean, that was a big goal too, was like not to look like, oh, you're looking at a device on a phone. It's like, it needs to feel like this phone is your tool. Like Joel says in the opening, he's like, I see you've already checked out the armory. And so everyone just, you've already got it. You're already in the world. It's just like a good movie or a good story. You are starting late into the story. Like, you already live in this world and we're just trying to catch you up, kind of.
Yeah, and I think the screens are quite good at that. I think you all did a great job with the videos in particular to make it look like the phone was still on. And I'm curious how many people had trouble with the app out here. Nearly everyone? Yeah. At the Marriott, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, we kind of had to, unfortunately, make you just take a picture of nothing and then show it to you in the evidence. I don't know why, but our... maybe it was the Wi-Fi, but I don't know, recognition of those images was not working particularly quickly.
I got a fingerprint.
Yeah. Yeah, so you could still get the evidence even if it didn't load. I know it's working. How many of y'all went to the crime scene not today? How many of y'all went earlier? Okay, yeah. Today, I mean, I was in this morning. It's working perfect. So we were smoothing some stuff out. If you went Friday especially, we were all in crisis mode Friday.
We did not get a full walkthrough of the app and get all the bugs out until something like 5:30 p.m.
Yeah, I think we greenlit the crime scene. I was trying to hold it, I think, and then they just opened it or something. And we had tested that. We knew the crime scene worked, and we were still out testing, and they opened it. And we're like, oh, God, there's going to be people like right behind us. So we were like right in front.
Yeah, and the thing is, they beat us. How did that happen? We were going as quickly as possible, knowing exactly where we needed to be from clue to clue.
Yeah.
And the people that beat us.
Yeah, how did y'all do it so fast? We know where to win. I was running almost.
If you go, they talk about he's involved in the Rooster Teeth. This might have been a little obtuse. But So he's using the alias Ernie Smulders, and he's involved in the Rooster Teeth community. I think the clue, I don't remember what the text is in the app, but it's something, it's hopefully like, you know, what else was he involved in, and what does that mean, blah, blah, blah. So if you actually go to the Rooster Teeth website, roosterteeth.com, type in Ernie Smulders. There is a fake profile for Ernie Smulders, and you will see on his comment wall that he has had a conversation with Carrie Kilpowski, and they agreed to, he sequestered to stay with him for the weekend at RTX, so that's why he was in the room. Cool. Yes, sir. There's blood trails there. That again, you know, mixing because there's a little troubleshooting tech wise, and even with if you did the QR version, that just literally tells you where to go. But you basically find the blood you find in the chalk outline will give you a picture, and that if you go there and scan the thing, there's a blood trail that leads under the escalators. You go there, another picture. You kind of follow this three trail that eventually takes you to the payphone. So there's three different locations on the way. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Probably not Windows. I mean, you know.
We only have one developer on our in our company, and it's me. And so that's why the Android app couldn't come out. And I apologize to all you Android users. But yes, definitely, we're thinking of making one.
Yeah, I think if so, if this happens again next year, which I hope it does, so you know, make noise out there. Say, you know, I love this. I want to get married there.
Yeah. Seriously, tweeting about it and stuff like that is really, really helpful in terms of us being able to do more.
Yeah. But. But yeah, I think I can say with pretty good certainty that if we come back and do it again next year, we will put that will be my top priority. We'll be having the Android version ready too. So let's see. I'm gonna go to the back. Are you raising your hand? Okay.
We have a story right now on the east side of Austin called Live at the Dead Horse Drum.
Cool. And is it outside in any other cities?
No, not yet. We're developing a lot of different stories outside of Rooster Teeth, but I want to keep your expectations kind of low. They are not nearly as immersive or as cool as this one.
You can talk a little bit about that one, about the one that's in East Austin right now. So, you guys basically went around outside, hid beacons and trees and wherever else, right? And now you can just go with the app and go there, and it'll ping you when you're.
Yeah, this story is not so. It's more of a collage story, I guess. So you get bits and pieces of a story, but they don't necessarily have to be linear or taken in any particular order. But you get more of a. It's more of a pastiche where the story is sort of enveloped all in pieces.
Yeah, it's a non-linear story. It doesn't have like a definitive end. You go and you get the pieces, and it's just more about walking there and being in the area. Yeah.
And you guys have developed an API, haven't you? Or
we're working on it. So Asunder is a really new app. Like we basically presented it at South by in March. So just meeting Brian and working on this project has really kind of been our kind of big kind of entree into the thing. The story we had before was done with friends, you know, was done on zero budget, and it was more of a proof of concept. So we're hopefully going to develop more.
Yeah, I think our first story had 40 viewers total, and I know that 20 of them were my friends.
wouldn't you like these guys to develop more with us to do more things like this?
And Sam's phone's still ringing.
I missed it.
He missed. Yeah, we'll wait. We'll do one final one if they call back at the end.
So we can hear them.
Yeah. Oh, I don't know. We'll see. We'll wing it if they come.
I was just saying if we get them, we should put
to my phone. Okay. Speakerphone.
I don't. I feel that's a lot of pressure. You did so good. To answer.
Yeah, speakerphone, just so we can hear them talking.
You can just still put it on speakerphone. You don't need me for that. I can just hang out. To answer that question, I would love to do more of this stuff. This kind of stuff is like outside of Rooster Teeth. We just have to figure out a way to make it, you know, feasible and be able to get people to do it. And I don't know. Well, I'm sure after this we'll have lots of brainstorming and figure some cool stuff out. In the blue. That might be coming out. Did people see that? Did no one see that trailer yesterday?
Yeah.
Like in their city or wherever they are, or what?
If we were to do that, it would have to probably be a different mechanism. So the way Asunder works and what they've developed is very location. Like you need, you know, it works really well for doing theatrical and storytelling stuff because you're walking around and accessing the beacons. There would have to be something else that, you know, would be kind of more web centric, probably.
Yeah, I mean, if you when we do 11 Little Roosters next year, there will be some more interactive scavenger hunty type things with it. It's a different form of interaction than 10 Little Roosters was. But it's I think those are both very catered again, like to their mediums. So this is a live medium. It's a little hard. There's probably a way to do it. We'd have to really find a cool hook, though, to it, a mechanism that would let us do that.
You know, there was another panel during that whole South by programming that, you know, I think could apply.
Was that the Game of Thrones one?
Yeah, it was the Game of Thrones one.
Oh, yeah, that was cool.
That was really cool. So who knows? Maybe.
No, there was. There's a Game of Thrones advertising panel about their advertising campaign in...
It was in Spain, and it was done by like the Spanish distributor of Game of Thrones. And they basically had another country in that world that was put together. And there was a rebel that they staged an event to introduce, like a live event in Madrid. And then it expanded out into, like, there was a Facebook thing and a Twitter, and basically and it's hard to explain the mechanism, but people were allowed to go to war against each other on a specific day every week, and based on the way the wars went, there were factions and stuff that rose up, and they joined together into different armies, and the leader of the top army was declared king in a crowning ceremony in Spain. It was like, yeah, if you go to, I can try and find the link, but South By has audio archives of all of the panels, and the one for this panel was super crazy. It was like all of the stuff they were talking, it was like, oh my God, really, what? It was like, but yeah, they had a whole crowning ceremony with like a procession through Madrid, like they put this guy up, you know, in a chair that they were carrying down the street, and it was really, really cool.
Man.
So maybe 11 Little Roosters.
Yeah. Yep. Gentleman in the hat. I don't. I think just finally seeing it all come together, because for so many, you know, for weeks and weeks, it's there's so many individual moving parts. I mean, Marcus is working on the sets, and Sam and Lisa are working on the app, and we, you know, we're throwing art assets between everyone, and I'm making the videos and all stuff. But it's such so many
How's it going? Oh my goodness. What are you guys doing here? You should be out solving this thing. Why are you? Raise your hand if you're done, if you've completely solved it. All right, well done.
Good job, detectives.
How many people thought was it hard? Was it, where did it fall difficulty-wise for y'all? It was hard? I'm sorry. Yeah. Did you enjoy it, though? Did you at least have fun? Okay. Cool. Well, we're going to talk a little. Let me introduce my team. This is Brian Beam.
Hello, everybody.
My other producer on this. Sam, I'm blanking on your last name.
It's Pattison.
Sam Pattison and Lisa Woods. Sorry. My brain is a little fried today. These lovely people are from the Asunder app that you guys were using to look at fingerprints and blood and get calls from Chris Damaris, who's the number one hugger in the department.
I can verify that. Mm-hmm. I've gotten good hugs from him.
And then on the end here, we have Marcus Laporte, who did all your beautiful sets that you guys enjoyed.
Second best hugger at the...
Yeah. Your mic doesn't work. Oh.
You can hear me, right?
Yeah, we're thinking pretty... Are you guys... We can split. Oh, we'll figure it out. Okay. So I guess we'll just kind of walk y'all through the process of how this thing got made, and then we'll just open it up for questions if you guys want to hear some stuff. So this all started after I did 10 Little Roosters. That was kind of my attempt to look at what you could do with a web series as a medium. I've repeated this a bunch, so sorry if this feels redundant if you've been to some of the other panels. But that was... me looking at a web series and trying to say, like, what can this medium do that other mediums can't? Because a lot of the stuff you see on the web now
is basically like a web series for the most part is a shorter TV series, right? And so I was trying to see if it could be something more than that. And what's cool about the history of Rooster Teeth, especially, is that they've done this, you know, several times before. Red versus Blue is such a great example. They looked at something like Halo in an in-game engine, and they saw production software. You know, they saw special effects assets and all these things that other people didn't. And they used this medium of gaming for something else that it could do, you know, and spawned what I think eventually became, you know, Let's Plays and all these other things. So kind of inspired by that and having done 10 Little Roosters, and I had done RTX last year actually as well, but I just had a handful of panels. And so coming into this year, I was trying to think, what could I do if the convention itself was viewed as a medium for entertainment? Like what kind of story could you tell and what kind of experience could you give? And so that was the genesis. And I think I had the crime scene idea fairly early, because that seemed such a great place with rich texture and this investigation you could do, and if you were retracing someone's day, you could you know, go all over the convention trying to figure out what happened to this person. I think it ended up, did you guys end up walking a lot for this? So sweet, I should sell this to like Gatorade or something. So my initial iteration, though, was very pen and paper. It was like, okay, well, they're going to go, and they're going to have to kind of keep the clues themselves, and they're going to have to figure out the logic, and I didn't have video calls or anything. And then I'll let Brian take it from here.
So kind of my bad habit at Rooster Teeth is that I like to get us into new areas of trouble. And so, you know, I'm one of the people at RT that figures out some way to go to South by Southwest every year. And one of the reasons I go is to go and try and find cool stuff that's going on that we can take and, like, integrate with what we're doing. And so Josh had been talking to me about where he was going next with, you know, the whole 10 Little Roosters thing. And I stumbled on, it was actually kind of inadvertent, I was running around and I've been really interested in VR lately, and South by this year had a whole thread on VR, but also just interactive AR, kind of augmented reality and virtual reality storytelling. And I walked into a panel that was dealing with using something called Bluetooth beacons as a narrative storytelling method. And the Asunder people and some other people were on this panel, and you know, they're talking about this really great thing that they did that they'll get into in a second, where they had a basically story that unraveled as you wandered around the bar district on 6th on the other side of 35, and suddenly things are connecting in my head that it's like, huh, we can apply this to what Josh is doing, and I think this might be the thing that, you know, because pen and paper works, but, you know, I think if we have some method to direct them, you know, it might help kind of smooth out some of the process, and it might allow us to do things that Rooster Teeth is really good at, like developing video content, you know, and so I kind of brought it to him as like, hey, you know, what if we do this? You know, what if we think about doing that? Go look at this app and, you know, take a look at it.
And what did that app do? That was your setup. Go.
Oh, what? Oh, we're on. Yeah, Lisa and I made this app because I think we were looking at some Bluetooth technology, and the only thing people seem to be using it for is to sell things to you in the store, give you a coupon or something. And I don't think we were interested in doing that at all. But we saw a play that was an audio play, and you would walk around this park here in town, Laguna Gloria, was that it? And it was in August, like now, so it was all hot, and it was like a swamp out there. And the play was Hamlet, I think, as performed by Scottish actors. And you would walk around and have to press play on a CD player to hear parts of it. So you hear these Scottish actors, you know, you're thinking there should be on the moors, but we're sitting in the middle of this Texas swamp. And it didn't really, like, connect at all with us. So we thought maybe we could use these Bluetooth beacons to add a little layer to stories if you're walking around town, to pick them up and maybe hear something in situ while you're there.
And as Josh mentioned, you guys were doing a lot of walking, and we kind of feel like people, I mean, you're staring at your phone a lot, right? And sometimes we've talked about how that gets in the way of people interacting with each other, especially in their environment. And so we wanted to think about, can we use the phone in a way that actually gets you out and looking at stuff and interacting with your environment more? So that was actually part of the drive for it as well.
Yeah. And with the sets, the way they are, Marcus, maybe you can talk about that. Like, I think that's the most interesting part of it for me is how that all interacts with the story, too.
Yeah. Yeah, let Marcus tell you how I stressed him out for the last 3 months. I want you to build a 1930s crime scene. Go.
Yeah, we were trying to be sort of time ambiguous. I mean, we're definitely in an era, but we knew that we would have to draw from a couple of different decades to really kind of complete the deal here. Obviously, the speakeasy is a little earlier than the 40s noir, but we were trying to kind of give everyone a little bit of all the fun stuff from the 20s to 40s. But yeah, we searched high and low for some period furniture and found lots of fun little things. And you guys all saw it all already.
What did you think of the sets? Did you like the sets?
Yeah.
Did you like the CB lounge? That front projection screen, that was all Marcus. I was going to do this really cheap like Home Alone effect where I was going to put like two mannequins and just backlight it, and they were just going to be standing there like this. And he was like, I think I have a better idea.
Yeah, well, we for a while I kind of went with the cardboard concept because I was like, well, let's see how far this goes and let's just flesh out the idea and play with all the elements. And sometimes things come and go. So I try never to really... I never really poo-poo any idea that kind of comes through the creative process. I try to stay away from that part. You know, I'm there to motivate and enhance and make things cool, not to change the writer's creativity, hopefully. Sometimes we have limitations, and I have to say, well, we can't do that, but we could do this, and hopefully the this is still cool. So, but, yeah, we did the front projection, and...
didn't get in here until I guess Thursday at 6 p.m.
Yeah, so that crime scene was built in 18 hours.
Yeah.
I slept on the floor under a sound blanket like a hobo. Yeah. It was great.
And I almost did that, but I was like, no, I need clothes.
you didn't want to sleep in the hotel bed?
Well, I wasn't offered a hotel. So.
Oh, no, in the crime scene.
Oh, just in the crime scene.
I was like, there was no hotel for me. Yeah, and I was like, nobody sit on the pillow.
Why did you, what is the story there? See, Marcus, I was going to jump on the bed as a joke, and he's like, don't do that, cat piss. And I was like, what the hell does that mean?
When we went and picked up some of the stuff, I mean, they're like, you know, it's in this guy's, if you don't know, we have a guy named Tom Cole. He has a lot of old stuff, and it gathers dust, and he has a big warehouse full of period items. And, you know, they don't get rented very often. So when we go in there, you know, you never know what you're going to find. So it's like, you know, raccoons or, you know, there's like animals in his warehouse sometimes. So I just, you know, this pillow smelled a little funny and I just wanted to make sure you didn't go lay your, you know, head on it. That's all. Your pretty hair.
Thank you. I did just get it cut and shampooed on Thursday. So
Sam and Lisa, what did you think when, like, you guys didn't know who Rooster Teeth were, did you? When we, like, kind of came up out of the blue? It was like, what's your experience been like? It was just like,
I've been amazed at just the community here. Everybody seems so nice, and you have like so much fun. And I think 3 weeks. I mean, I'd heard of Red versus Blue, obviously. I mean, that's everywhere. I remember when that came out and being amazed that someone thought of such an awesome idea to save so much money and time to make a show. You know, it was great. But everybody we've met here has been super nice and super friendly, and I maybe you guys don't know how many people are like behind the scenes, like doing all of this stuff. Even the Guardians have been great, and they've been stayed like, you know, the volunteer actors at the speakeasy. That Jake Hill, who answers the door, isn't he fantastic? Yeah.
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 I think everybody, I've just been really amazed by the community, and everybody, I really, really want to watch more Rooster Teeth now for sure.
Woo!
Let's see how we're doing on time. Okay. We're doing good.
Should we move to questions, or do you have anything else you want to cover?
I feel like there was something, but I forgot.
My
again.
Brain is so gone.
I know. I guess feedback. I mean, did you guys feel like you got a cohesive experience? Did you like the story? Like, did you feel like you got a good full story? How many people thought someone they were talking to on the video calls was going to end up being bad? Okay, damn it. I had tried to design that where they felt more like a advisory mechanism, and the suspects were the only ones that mattered. Yeah. How many people knew it was going to be Chris? How many people thought it was going to be someone else? Anyone think it was going to be Joel or Barbara or someone or Aaron? Oh, but it's a different Barbara. Did you look at the last names? All the last names are like nonsense. Look at Marcus made that.
I made all that.
Mine's like
I was gonna use real names, and then at some point it was like, no, that's gonna confuse the audience with the actual characters that are in there. And so I was like, well, I want to use Rooster Teeth names, so I just started, finding. Little funny little things. Was it Dunkermang or something?
Yeah. I think mine...
It was Barra Dunkermang.
Yeah. And mine was like a weird... If y'all know Zach, I don't know if this was your intention, but like... Yeah, like mine looked like the love child of me and Zach Anner. It was Josh Flynn Anner.
I thought for a moment it was one of the names that's... Basil calls the little girl in the Great Master Tech.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty close to that. Yeah, I was pretty delirious at that point, and I was just like, okay, I'll just start, rhyming and finding, little synonyms for these last names.
Yeah.
And it was based off Ernie Smulders, though.
Yeah, Ernie Smulders was mine. Yeah. Wasn't that good?
And then I was like, okay, if that's his idea, then I know I'm safe to kind of play off that same
thing. Well, that was the thing, too. I kind of wanted to, even though it's at Rooster Teeth, I wanted to use the expo, but I wanted to make it a standalone story. So it wasn't, it was like... That worked in 10 Little Roosters, but this one was going to be, the people were going to be playing characters, even though they're, iterations of themselves. So
out of curiosity, just so that I know who to, beware of in the room, how many went bad at the end? Okay, let's...
Yeah. Oh, how many people enjoyed did you guys enjoy the Rooster Teeth cameos that are all over it? Did you guys, did y'all call all the phone numbers besides his? Yeah, you like... I was worried some of those were going to throw people off. Like, his and Lindsay's was like a voluntary amputation business or something. And I was like, I wondered. I knew someone was going to think that. I'd hoped the timeline would clear that up, which is supposed to be the point, because Miles' phone call comes during the murder, which means he's busy, and then the other one, shortly after. But, yeah, when you have people pitching stabbing companies, it's... That do y'all know who that was? No, it's Matt. It's Matt Hullum. Yeah, same in the speakeasy too. There's a bunch of people talking. That's Ryan again and John Reisinger.
Gray is
Blaine.
In there.
Yep, Aaron. Yep.
Haley.
No, she's the silhouettes. The silhouettes and the people are different. So yeah, it's different voices. I think we could do questions. That was
Jen
Brown.
Okay. I thought it was.
What's her... I'm going to mess her character up. Someone knows.
She's Carolina.
Carolina, thank you. Yeah, Carolina and Redbird.
She's Agent Iowa.
I'm trying to think if anyone else was in there. I think that's...
That's a pretty... Yeah, I think that's...
Yeah, everybody. Do you guys want to do some... Do you got questions? Do people have questions? I hope so. What's the mechanism? Raised hands.
I think you start with the pink hair.
Cool. Yeah. Where... Oh, okay. I know you. Yes, we're gonna film. I'm running around day, and then I have a signing over at JW, so I'm gonna pick up the last piece there. But I'm gonna film the speakeasy and all the beacons and stuff. So that was one of the things we wanted to do for people who couldn't be here, was to film a little bit like a narrative walkthrough of the whole thing where you could, you know, post the videos online and things like that. So that'll be coming out probably in the next few weeks. So, which also means it, when we do it again, even if we were to keep the detective thing, we'd have to make a totally new story and puzzles. So yeah.
Aww.
Let's see. Green shirt. I think the Guardians are keeping some tally of that at the end goal. I know as of a ton of people were finishing yesterday. I know, or today. I know as of yesterday, only like low 50s had finished, like 52 people or something. Only 4 people finished it Friday. Are they here? Am I fitting? There you are. Yeah.
Though 10 minutes before this panel, we had 2,200 different sessions, according to. But that's just on iOS.
Yeah.
Like only for Friday, probably, right?
Yeah, those numbers hopefully will go up, yeah. Right?
So we're trying to track it as best we can because we're curious too, and like if, you know, if there's a way to get more people through, and also as a sexy sales tool for people to sponsors to throw money at us, so we can make a bigger, awesomer one each time. So, yeah. Let's see, hey, blue. Yeah. So the clue, I don't think a lot of people did. Did anyone figure that out? The website is the Rooster Teeth website. So